So .NET stands for Network Enabled Technology. It is a system which can be used for developing any type of application, whether it is a console, Windows, web or mobile based application. Okay.
Okay.
Last time I told you .NET is a technology, not a language.
Okay.
It's not a programming. It's a technology which consists three things: languages, technologies, and the server. When we talk about,
okay,
it can be a C#, VB, F#, J#. Lot of languages are there.
Then okay.
Talk about technologies. ADO.NET. ADO.NET. You know what is ADO.NET?
ADO.NET is a framework or which we use to database connectivity from.
Correct.
Hello. Hello. Yeah. Could you call me after 1 hour? I am busy right now. Who is this? Okay.
So see, technologies, when we talk about technologies, it is a ADO.NET and ASP.NET. Okay, this is the thing which we are discussing. In terms of now we have a MVC. Web API. These things, because document was prepared 10 years back or 12 years back. So that is why so that time Web API was not there. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Technologies, when we talk about technology, so it consists ADO.NET, ASP.NET, MVC, Web API. These are the technologies.
Okay.
So these are the technologies. So what, when we talk about ADO.NET, see, whenever you created an application and that application should communicate with the databases. So this .NET is a bridge between the programming language and the database.
Okay.
Front end and the database. If you want to communicate with the database, you have to use. Earlier, .NET, we had ADO, Active Data Object.
Okay.
I'm talking about Microsoft's older technology. We had ADO, A-D-O, Active Data Object, which is used in VB, Visual Basic, for communicating for databases. Now, when Microsoft has launched the .NET technology, ADO converted into the ADO.NET.
Okay.
The object.NET. It means if I wanted to communicate with the databases, I have to use the medium we called as ADO.NET. Now, in the recent time, it gets enhanced by ADO.NET Entity Framework.
Okay.
Earlier it was ADO.NET, now we called as ADO.NET Entity Framework. Okay?
Okay, Ashwin. Okay.
It's nothing but if you wanted to build a server-side web application, we have to go for ASP.NET.
Okay.
.NET stand for Active Server Pages.
Oh, yeah.
To identify the ASP.NET pages. So whenever you are opening any of the application on the browser, so if you have some extension, if the page having the extension ASPX, then we can say this is a this application built in ASP.NET or the .NET technology.
If the page
having JSP.JSP, it means a Java server pages, we talk about Java. If it is an HTML, that means it's a HTML application. If it is .php, it becomes a PHP application. We have ASP.NET. So you can find the ASP.NET by checking the ASPX pages. ASP.NET, I'll tell you something. Let's talk about something called, actually, the thing is getting moved it in the routing concept, MVC architecture. So for now, just understand this way, ASPX, you will find this ASPX at the end. So it is
okay.
If it is .php, it will become as a PHP application. If it is JSP, Java application. If it is HTML, it becomes an HTML application. Okay.
Okay.
Now the market is being changed. Technology has been upgraded. So you won't be able to see the extension of your application into the browser URL.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but earlier, still, you will find lot of pages which is built in ASP.NET. You can see.
Yeah, it would be ASPX. Yeah.
Yeah. HDFC Bank website is HDFC Bank website is built in two ways. One is the part of whenever you will find the payment related things. So that that particular pages is built in Java JSP, and rest of the HDFC Bank website is built in ASP.NET. Okay.
Okay, Ashwin. Okay.
.NET has introduced to overcome the drawbacks in the traditional technology like component object model. Let's talk about component object model. It means, as I told you yesterday, the .NET people, how the Java .NET applications is getting built on the Windows environment. There is an operating system. In the top of your operating system, you have a CLR. On the top of the CLR, you have your .NET application. This is okay. The structure now. Okay. I'm not creating any arrow sign. You can understand with this way. This is the hardware. This is the operating system. Operating system is on your what we called hardware. On the top of your hardware, you have operating system. In the operating system, you have the CLR, and on the top of the CLR, you have a .NET application.
Okay.
So what was happening? Component object model. The application, now let's talk about, I'm ignoring this .NET application, I'm talking about VB. VB does not have any CLR framework there. So
okay.
It is directly communicating with your operating system.
Okay.
That's hardware. Directly communicating. So if you built an Visual Basic application in the Windows machine, and Windows having some different different hardware configuration, so this particular VB application is not going to be run in any other machine, because this application was built in different configuration, maybe Windows environment, maybe Linux environment, or the configuration of the hardware would be changed. So now this was the COM object, component object model, the application which is directly communicating with your operating system, the application which is directly communicating with your hardware, that type okay. of application we called as COM object. For example, if I wanted to integrate Windows Media Player in my web application or in the Windows application, I can integrate it. But that Windows application is Windows Media Player is directly associated with your operating system.
Okay.
Not relying on your framework or anything. But still I can integrate in my application, which is .NET. So Windows Media Player is a part of your operating system and directly communicating with your hardware. That we called as a component object model. Why the .NET introduced? The other reason was to compete with the Java language. Because as I told you day before yesterday, Java is a platform independent language, because
okay.
every operating system will have or already have the JVM, Java Virtual Machine, in their inbuilt operating system. That feature is already inbuilt in your hardware in your machine. So that is we called as a platform independent. But I wanted to make my application, my technology as a platform independent. Microsoft has introduced this .NET technology, because earlier Microsoft Visual Basic was communicating with the operating system, directly with the operating system and the hardware. So it was a platform dependent. So if Microsoft, at that time Microsoft wanted to build an environment where a .NET application run on any environment with any operating system. That is why the Microsoft introduced .NET technology. But still .NET is a platform dependent, because it cannot run .NET, it cannot, the .NET application is not going to run in your Linux machine.
Okay.
If you want me to run it, now I can tell you, yes, .NET core is a platform independent. But when we talk about .NET, .NET is a platform independent, platform dependent. It's a partial independent. Partial independent means once you built an application in the Windows environment, that application run on any Windows machine. Because operating okay. system are same in different machines. Now, what is .NET? .NET is a collection of languages where a developer or the programmer or the user can choose any language to build an application. Now, how the compilation process is going on? Whenever you build an application, whether it is in C# or VB, the C# code is going to be converted into CIL. CIL stands for Common Intermediate Language. So who will be responsible for converting C# language code into CIL? CSC. CSC is my compiler. Once the CIL code, or you can say MSIL, Microsoft Intermediate Language, or Common Intermediate Language, once your CIL code is generated, now I can say CIL code is not related to C#, it's not related to VB, it's an independent code that can be consumed by any technology or any language. So once your CIL code gets generated, now the CLR will come into the picture, which will convert your code into the machine language. Because machine okay. doesn't know C#, doesn't know any programming language. Machine only understands 0 or 1.
Okay, Ashwin.
Byte format data, right? Or native.
Okay.
So once the CSC is the C# compiler is responsible for converting your C#.NET code into CIL or MSIL. Once your code gets converted into the MSIL or CIL, the CLR will come into the picture and it will convert your CIL code into the machine code so that your machine can understand what the language wanted to say, what he needs to perform. Similarly, VB language, we have a VBC, VB compiler, code gets converted into CIL, and CIL goes, the CLR will convert your CIL code into machine code so that machine can understand it. Now, language interoperability. As we discussed yesterday, interoperability means what? I created a program in C# language. That program can be consumed by other languages also. Interoperability meaning C# code gets converted into the CIL, and CIL can be used, can be consumed by any .NET language. That we call as an language interoperability. The advantage of all languages generating same type of IL code means whatever the language you have in the .NET platform, in the .NET technology, every language is easy to understand. Means if I'm using J#, so J# is nothing but your Java program. You have created a program in Java and I wanted to consume that Java program into my .NET language in the C#. So what will happen? Your J# code gets converted into the CIL, and CIL can be understood by any other .NET language. That feature we called as language interoperability. Initially, it was started with .NET Framework 2.0. Now, this is the very important things when you go for the interview. Let's see. What is partial class? You need to tell me now. What is partial class?
No idea.
Okay. Let's talk about. See, it is very useful for the interview preparation. That is why I'm going for the theoretical part for now. Okay. Partial.
Okay.
What do you understand by partial? Tell me. Anything. I'm not talking about class. What do you understand by partial? Tell me.
Partial means...
Anything.
Partial classes are nothing but where we can define two sources means same functionality can be same classes can be used by two people, two programmers.
Correct, true. Let's talk about in a different way. A class can be divided into two physical files.
Okay.
A class can be divided into two physical files. That is called a partial class.
Okay.
I'll create the sample for you. Okay, don't worry. Okay.
Okay, Ashwin.
Let's take in a scenario. Okay. Ashwin and Pavitra.
Okay.
Ashwin and Pavitra are working as a developer. Okay.
Yeah.
And both has created. Both are responsible for writing some business logic.
That we tried, Ashwin, but it did not work out in our company, last company. Mm-hmm. We created partial classes. I don't know where we wrong. We tried it, but it did not work out.
And don't worry, I'll do it. Okay, no worry.
Okay,
I'll do it. Whatever I'm going to tell you now, I'll do the practical and you'll understand. The most important part is here is if you know the concept, okay, you can search the program in the Google, you will get a lot of things. But the only thing is that if you understand the flow, understand the concept, easily you can do that, those things. Let's talk about partial. You already given the answer, but still I am repeating it. Partial class means if I wanted to split a class into two physical files, then we have to go for partial class. Let's take an example. Pavitra and Ashwin is working as a developer, and both peoples are responsible for writing the business logic for employee. Means there should be a one class, an employee, and Pavitra is responsible for writing add record in database. And Ashwin is responsible for delete record in the database for that particular employee. So both are sitting in two different machines. How the both though these two peoples work together in single file or single class at a time, only one people can work on it. So what will happen? Will create. Okay, so we were talking about, we have classes. One is there is one class, an employee. Pavitra is responsible for adding a record, and Ashwin is responsible for deleting a record. Both people are two different machines. So how they will work on the same class? It won't be possible. So what they will do, what we can do, we will create one class called an employee. Another person, means Ashwin, is also creating the same type of same name class, public partial employee.
Okay.
What will happen? Once you execute the program, all the classes which have the same name, it will be converted into the single unit.
Okay.
If you have written a method add, and Ashwin has written a method at delete, so whoever the person who is going to consume that employee class, he will be getting add method as well as delete method.
Okay, Ashwin.
Got it?
Got it, Ashwin.
Shall I share you?
Yeah, Ashwin.
See, now the other part is generic and the parameterized type. Let's talk about generic. Okay. So generic, you can say, I wanted to create a type which can accept any type of data, be called as a generic. If I am creating a generic type of list, that means if I am passing as a T object to a class, so it will accept employee type, it will accept integer type, it will accept any type of data. That we called as a generic type classes or parameterized type. Static classes cannot be instantiated. Static classes cannot be instantiated. Any idea why? Static methods. Static methods means, static means a method or the class which is defined or declared as a static. So memory allocation for those methods and the classes will be allocated at the time of compilation of your code. Okay, so in that case, when once your application got executed, you should not be worried about to create the instance of the class, because when we talk about creating the instance of the class, it means you are allocating the memory to an object. But here what happens, at the compilation time, you already given the memory to the static class. So if the memory is already allocated to the static class, do you think I need to create an object of the class?
No, static classes, we can't create objects.
Why? Why? The reason is being because memory was already allocated. If you create an object to a particular class, then it will allocate the memory, right? But in the static concept, the memory was already allocated. So that is the reason I cannot create the object of that class, because memory was already allocated there, right? So that is called a static. Now then we talk about nullable value types. Nullable value types means I created an integer variable, okay? And I have an integer variable I created. From the database, I'm getting null value. Okay, if you try to store the null value into the integer type variable, it will throw an exception. So we have an option called nullable types. You can create a nullable data types. If somehow in some situation, if null value is coming, so it won't throw any error. We called as a nullable types. Okay. There are some features called coalesce operator. Coalesce operator means question marks, two question marks. It means it's a one-liner operation. One-liner operation means just like we were doing if else. Okay. If else. So similarly, we can use the coalesce operator. If the value come, then assign. Otherwise else, assign something else. Earlier we were doing if else condition. If it is null, then assign. Else, then assign. But in the coalesce operator, you can do the same thing with one line. Okay. There are other things called anonymous delegates. Okay. Anonymous delegates means what happened whenever you are creating any function. Okay. You were supposed to define it over there. For example, public void add record, curly braces open, curly braces close. Inside the block, you have written your business logic. Okay. Now, but the method which you have created, that is going to be invoked from somewhere. Then it will perform the operation, right? You created a method add record. Until or unless you will not call it, it won't work. Correct. So there are two types of things you are doing it. Creating the function and calling the function. There are two things you are doing it. Now, when we talk about anonymous delegate, it means, we'll talk about delegates later. Anonymous delegate means I don't need to create a function, then call it. Wherever I am just calling it, I can define it over there itself. Means public void add record. Then in the main function, you are calling add record. Simple. The traditional way which we were doing it. Now, why should I create a function and call it? So in the main function directly, I can write the business logic by using the anonymous. So there is some syntax. So you can directly define the methods over there and it will automatically get called. You don't need to call it separately. That is called anonymous. Now, in the Angular .NET 3.0 framework version, we got LingQ. LingQ stands for Language Integrated Query. Okay. Language Integrated Query means, if I'm a programmer, I do not have a knowledge on database side. I'm a programmer. I do not have a knowledge in database side. Okay. Now, so But I'm very much comfortable on writing the programs or writing the business logics. So, and I'm not comfortable with the database side. If somebody is asking me, can you write, can you join the two tables in the database? If somebody will ask me, I can say, no, no, I don't have knowledge how to write it. But if somebody is asking me, can you write a join between two classes? I'm a programmer. I can do it very easily by in the C#. So in that case, what does it mean? Whatever you have in the database, which you are which tables, columns, and everything, automatically the link you in the entity framework, the database is going to be converted into the programmer side. The tables are getting converted into the entity. Entity nothing but a class. The columns of the table is going to be converted into the properties. I can write the code from my end to make a join between two classes, two entities, instead of going to the database, write the join query and all those things. If you are very good in object-oriented programming, you can utilize your skill on link your entity framework. I don't be bothered about to write those things in the database side, so I can use it. In simple words, I can say, whatever you are doing in the database side, you can do it into the C# side. That is called link queue. Object initializer and collections. Object initializers and collections means whenever you are creating an object, I can assign the value and it will automatically allocate the memory to that object. For example, employee obj equals to new employee, curly braces open, close, and assign a value directly there. Means I can assign the value directly when defining the particular class object. That is called object initializer. Then we had something called lambda expression. Leave it that lambda expression. It's a part of link queue and all those things. Automatic properties we have. Automatic properties means earlier, whenever the person is writing the code, he has to write a property. Property is nothing but if you wanted to share the data between one layer to another layer, you have to create a property. I wanted to send my employee name from one class to another class. You should have a property. Then you will be able to transfer your data from here to there. So earlier, the developers was writing the code before 3.0 framework, public, integer, name, ID, pub, then get, then set. In the get, they have to assign... read the value in the set, they have to assign the value. So it was a very lengthy work there. Now, when we talk about automatic properties, we should not be worried about to define the properties just like we did earlier. We have to do public, integer, ID, curly braces, open, close, get, semicolon, set, semicolon, that's it. We called as automatic properties. I don't need to create in the earlier way, which we were doing getter and setter and all those things. We should not be doing like that. Now, we have the partial methods. As I told you, we have the partial classes. Similarly, we have the partial method. Okay, if that is, nobody is using this partial method concept in anywhere. Okay, now, why the C# came into the picture? Goals of the C# language. It is intent to simple, modern, and general purpose. Oops language, if you wanted to utilize the object-oriented concept, or it is a modern language, even though Visual Studio is also developed in C# language. It is a modern language right now. We have the garbage collections in the .NET framework. Garbage collection is responsible for allocating and deallocating the memory to a particular object. Okay. We have a feature called there are two types of data types. One is the value type, another is the reference type. Okay, value type means what? It is stored the data in the form of stack. Do you know stack?
Yeah, stack I know.
What it is? How the data is getting stored in stack? Anything?
Stacks are like
Correct, correct. Just like in simple language, I can say one thing. Might be you heard about there is a container where you can put your balls. A simple container, okay, where you can put your balls. So there is a sequence maintained. When you put one ball, the second ball will go on the top of the first ball. Then third ball will go on top of your second ball. Similarly, okay, this is we called as stack. When we talk about heap, that means there is a big container. If you put the ball, it will go somewhere. Another ball, it will go somewhere. Another ball, it will go somewhere. Okay, so this is called an heap. Got it? But when we... Yeah, coming. The first is value type is a stack form. And reference type, it is in the heap form.
Okay.
No. The first answer you have to tell, the value type data gets stored in stack and the reference type data is getting stored in heap. Okay. Stack means it is in the sequential data. In the heap, data will be stored in different areas. It is not in a fixed place. The another is value type. It's a fixed length. Fixed length means the container can have only 10 balls. This is a fixed length. But in the heap, fixed length. You cannot. Yes, correct. Okay. The stack follows the LIFO and the FIFO approach. The stack follows LIFO. Last in, first out. Take an example. You have a container. You put it one ball, second ball, third ball, fourth ball. So whatever the last ball you have put in, that can be going to be retrieved on the top first, right? We called as LIFO, last in, first out. The data which you have entered at the last, it will be going to be fetch it on the first. Okay, first request. Got it? Any doubt, any confusion till now? Oh, we have to